In a Hollow of the Hills. By Bret Harte. Podcast 3 of 5. Chapter 4. It can't be 3 pines yet, said a passenger's voice, in which the laziness of sleep still lingered, or else we've snoozed over 5 mile. I don't see no lights, what are we stopping for? The other passengers struggled to an upright position. One nearest the window opened it, its place was instantly occupied by the double muzzle of a shotgun. No one moved. In the awestricken silence the voice of the driver rose in drawling protestation. It ain't no business o' mine, but it sorter strikes me that you chaps are a playin' it just a little too fine this time. It ain't 3 miles from 3 Pines Station and 40 men. Of course, that's your lookout not mine. The audacity of the thing had evidently struck even the usually taciturn and phlegmatic driver into his first expostulation on record. Your thoughtful consideration does you great credit, said a voice from the darkness, and shall be properly presented to our manager, but at the same time we wish it understood that we do not hesitate to take any risks in strict attention to our business and our clients. In the meantime you will expedite matters, and give your passengers a chance to get an early tea at 3 Pines, by handing down that treasure box and mail pouch. Be careful in handling that blunderbuss you keep beside it, the last time it unfortunately went off, and I regret to say slightly wounded one of your passengers. Accidents of this kind, interfering, as they do, with the harmony and pleasure of our chance meetings, cannot be too highly deplored. By gosh, ejaculated an outside passenger in an audible whisper. Thank you, sir, said the voice quietly, but as I overlooked you, I will trouble you now to descend with the others. The voice moved nearer, and, by the light of a flaming bullseye cast upon the coach, it could be seen to come from a stout, medium-sized man with a black mask, which, however, showed half of a smooth, beardless face, and an affable yet satirical mouth. The speaker cleared his throat with the slight preparatory cough of the practiced orator, and, approaching the window, to Key's intense surprise, actually began in the identical professional and rhetorical style previously indicated by the minor. Circumstances over which we have no control, gentlemen, compel us to oblige you to alight, stand in a row on one side, and hold up your hands. You will find the attitude not unpleasant after your cramped position in the coach, while the change from its confined air to the wholesome night breeze of the Sierras cannot but prove salutary and refreshing. It will also enable us to relieve you of such so-called valuables and treasures in the way of gold dust and coin, which I regret to say too often are misapplied in careless hands, and which the teachings of the highest morality distinctly denominate as the root of all evil. I need not inform you, gentlemen, as businessmen, that promptitude and sealrighty of compliance will ensure dispatch, and shorten an interview which has been sometimes needlessly, and, I regret to say, painfully protracted. He drew back deliberately with the same monotonous precision of habit, and disclosed the muzzles of his Confederate's weapons still leveled at the passengers. In spite of their astonishment, indignation, and discomfiture, his practiced effrontery and deliberate display appeared in some way to touch their humorous sense, and one or two smiled hysterically, as they rose and hesitatingly filed out of the vehicle. It is possible, however, that the leveled shotguns contributed more or less directly to this result. Two masks began to search the passengers under the combined focus of the bullseyes, the shining gun barrels, and a running but still carefully prepared commentary from the spokesman. It is to be regretted that businessmen, instead of entrusting their property to the custody of the regularly constituted express agent, still continue to secrete it on their persons, a custom that, without enhancing its security, is not only an injustice to the express company, but a great detriment to dispatch. We also wish to point out that while we do not as a rule interfere with the possession of articles of ordinary personal use or adornment, such as simple jewelry or watches, we reserve our right to restrict by confiscation the vulgarity and unmanliness of diamonds and enormous fob chains. The act of spoliation was apparently complete, yet it was evident that the orator was restraining himself for a more effective climax. Clearing his throat again and stepping before the impatient but still mystified file of passengers, he reviewed them gravely. Then in a perfectly pitched tone of mingled pain and apology, he said slowly, "It would seem that, from no wish of our own, we are obliged on this present occasion to suspend one or two of our usual rules. We are not in the habit of interfering with the wearing apparel of our esteemed clients, but in the interests of ordinary humanity we are obliged to remove the boots of the gentleman on the extreme left, which evidently give him great pain and impede his locomotion. We also seldom deviate from our rule of obliging our clients to hold up their hands during this examination, but we gladly make an exception in favor of the gentleman next to him, and permit him to hand us the altogether too heavily weighted holster which presses upon his hip." "Gentlemen," said the orator, slightly raising his voice, with a deprecating gesture, "you need not be alarmed. The indignant movement of our friend, just now, was not to draw his revolver, for it isn't there." He paused while his companions speedily removed the farmer's boots and the miner's holster, and with a still more apologetic air approached the coach, where only the lady remained erect and rigid in her corner. "And now," he said with simulated hesitation, "we come to the last and to us the most painful suspension of our rules. On these very rare occasions, when we have been honored with the presence of the fair sex, it has been our invariable custom not only to leave them in the undisturbed possession of their property, but even of their privacy as well. It is with deep regret that on this occasion we are obliged to make an exception. For in the present instance, the lady, out of the gentleness of her heart and the politeness of her sex, has burdened herself not only with the weight but the responsibility of a package forced upon her by one of the passengers. We feel, and we believe, gentlemen, that most of you will agree with us, that so scandalous and unmanly an attempt to evade our rules and violate the sanctity of the lady's immunity will never be permitted. For your own sake, madam, we are compelled to ask you for the satchel under your seat. It will be returned to you when the package is removed." "One moment," said the professional man indignantly, "there is a man here whom you have spared, a man who lately joined us. Is that man," pointing to the astonished key, "one of your confederates?" "That man," returned the spokesman with a laugh, "is the owner of the Sylvan Hollow mine. We have spared him because we owe him some consideration for having been turned out of his house at the dead of night while the sheriff of Sierra was seeking us." He stopped, and then in an entirely different voice, and in a totally changed manner, said roughly, "Tumble in there, all of you, quick. And you, sir, Tukey, I'd advise you to ride outside. Now, driver, raise so much as a rein or a whiplash until you hear the signal, and by God, you'll know what next." He stepped back, and seemed to be instantly swallowed up in the darkness, but the light of a solitary bullseye, the holder himself invisible, still showed the muzzles of the guns covering the driver. There was a momentary stir of voices within the closed coach, but an angry roar of silence, from the darkness hushed it. The moments crept slowly by, all now were breathless. Then a clear whistle rang from the distance, the light suddenly was extinguished, the leveled muzzles vanished with it, the driver's lash fell simultaneously on the backs of his horses, and the coach leaped forward. The jolt nearly threw Key from the top, but a moment later it was still more difficult to keep his seat in the headlong fury of their progress. Again and again the lash descended upon the maddened horses, until the whole coach seemed to leap, bound, and swerve with every stroke. Cries of protest and even distress began to come from the interior, but the driver heeded it not. A window was suddenly let down, the voice of the professional man saying, "What's the matter? We're not followed. You are imperiling our lives by this speed," was answered only by, "Will some of ye throttle that DD fool," from the driver, and the renewed fall of the lash. The wayside trees appeared a solid plateau before them, opened, danced at their side, closed up again behind them, but still they sped along. Rushing down grades with the speed of an avalanche, they ascended again without drawing rein, and as if by sheer momentum, for the heavy vehicle now seemed to have a diabolical energy of its own. It ground scattered rocks to powder with its crushing wheels, it swayed heavily on ticklish corners, recovering itself with the resistless forward propulsion of the straining teams, until the lights of Three Pine Station began to glitter through the trees. Then a succession of yells broke from the driver, so strong and dominant that they seemed to outstrip even the speed of the unabated cattle. Lesser lights were presently seen running to and fro, and on the outermost fringe of the settlement the stage pulled up before a crowd of wondering faces, and the driver spoke. "We've been held up on the open road, by GD, not 3 miles from war ye men are sittin' here yawpin'. If thar's a man among ye that hasn't got the soul of a skunk, he'll foller and close in upon em before they have a chance to get into the brush." Having thus relieved himself of his duty as an enforced non-combatant, and allowed all further responsibility to devolve upon his recreant fellow employees, he relapsed into his usual taciturnity, and drove a trifle less recklessly to the station, where he grimly set down his bruised and discomfited passengers. As Key mingled with them, he could not help perceiving that neither the late orator's explanation of his exemption from their fate, nor the driver's surly corroboration of his respectability, had pacified them. For a time this amused him, particularly as he could not help remembering that he first appeared to them beside the mysterious horseman who someone thought had been identified as one of the masks. But he was not a little piqued to find that the fair unknown appeared to participate in their feelings, and his first civility to her met with a chilling response. Even then, in the general disillusion of his romance regarding her, this would have been only a momentary annoyance, but it strangely revived all his previous suspicions, and set him to thinking. Was the singular sagacity displayed by the orator in his search purely intuitive? Could anyone have disclosed to him the secret of the passengers' hoards? Was it possible for her while sitting alone in the coach to have communicated with the band? Suddenly the remembrance flashed across him of her opening the window for fresh air. She could have easily then dropped some signal. If this were so, and she really was the culprit, it was quite natural for her own safety that she should encourage the passengers in the absurd suspicion of himself. His dying interest revived. A few moments ago he had half resolved to abandon his quest and turn back at Three Pines. Now he determined to follow her to the end. But he did not indulge in any further sophistry regarding his duty, yet, in a new sense of honor, he did not dream of retaliating upon her by communicating his suspicions to his fellow passengers. When the coach started again, he took his seat on the top, and remained there until they reached Jamestown in the early evening. Here a number of his despoiled companions were obliged to wait, to communicate with their friends. Happily, the exemption that had made them indignant enabled him to continue his journey with a full purse. But he was content with a modest surveillance of the lady from the top of the coach. On arriving at Stockton, this surveillance became less easy. It was the terminus of the stage route, and the divergence of others by boat and rail. If he were lucky enough to discover which one the lady took, his presence now would be more marked, and might excite her suspicion. But here a circumstance, which he also believed to be providential, determined him. As the luggage was being removed from the top of the coach, he overheard the agent tell the expressman to check the lady's trunk to San Luis. Key was seized with an idea which seemed to solve the difficulty, although it involved a risk of losing the clue entirely. There were two routes to San Luis, one was by stage, and direct, though slower, the other by steamboat and rail, via San Francisco. If he took the boat, there was less danger of her discovering him, even if she chose the same conveyance. If she took the direct stage and he trusted to a woman's avoidance of the hurry of change and transshipment for that choice, he would still arrive at San Luis, via San Francisco, an hour before her. He resolved to take the boat. A careful scrutiny from a stateroom window of the arriving passengers on the gangplank satisfied him that she had preferred the stage. There was still the chance that in losing sight of her she might escape him, but the risk seemed small. And a trifling circumstance had almost unconsciously influenced him after his romantic and superstitious fashion as to this final step. He had been singularly moved when he heard that San Luis was the lady's probable destination. It did not seem to bear any relation to the mountain wilderness and the wild life she had just quitted. It was apparently the most antipathetic, incongruous, and inconsistent refuge she could have taken. It offered no opportunity for the disposal of booty, or for communication with the gang. It was less secure than a crowded town. An old Spanish mission and monastery college in a sleepy pastoral plain, it had even retained its old-world flavor amidst American improvements and social revolution. He knew it well. From the quaint college cloisters, where the only reposeful years of his adventurous youth had been spent, to the long Alameda, or double avenues of ancient trees, which connected it with the convent of Santa Luisa, and some of his youthful devotions, it had been the nursery of his romance. He was amused at what seemed to be the irony of fate, in now linking it with this folly of his maturer manhood, and yet he was uneasily conscious of being more seriously affected by it. And it was with a greater anxiety than this adventure had ever yet cost him that he at last arrived at the San Jose Hotel, and from a balcony corner awaited the coming of the coach. His heart beat rapidly as it approached. She was there. But at her side, as she descended from the coach, was the mysterious horseman of the Sierra Road. He could not mistake the well-built figure, whatever doubt there had been about the features, which had been so carefully concealed. With the astonishment of this rediscovery, there flashed across him again the fatefulness of the inspiration which had decided him not to go in the coach. His presence there would have no doubt warned the stranger, and so estopped this convincing denouement. It was quite possible that her companion, by relays of horses and the advantage of bridle cut-offs, could have easily followed the three pine coach and joined her at Stockton. But for what purpose? The lady's trunk, which had not been disturbed during the first part of the journey, and had been forwarded at Stockton untouched before Key's eyes, could not have contained booty to be disposed of in this forgotten old town. The register of the hotel bore simply the name of Mrs. Barker, of Stockton, but no record of her companion, who seemed to have disappeared as mysteriously as he came. That she occupied a sitting room on the same floor as his own, in which she was apparently secluded during the rest of the day, was all he knew. Nobody else seemed to know her. He felt an odd hesitation, that might have been the result of some vague fear of implicating her prematurely, in making any marked inquiry, or imperiling his secret by the bribed espionage of servants. Once when he was passing her door, he heard the sounds of laughter, albeit innocent and heart-free, which seemed so inconsistent with the gravity of the situation and his own thoughts that he was strangely shocked. But he was still more disturbed by a later occurrence. In his watchfulness of the movements of his neighbor, he had been equally careful of his own, and had not only refrained from registering his name, but had enjoined secrecy upon the landlord, whom he knew. Yet the next morning after his arrival, the porter not answering his bell promptly enough, he so far forgot himself as to walk to the staircase, which was near the lady's room, and call to the employee over the balustrade. As he was still leaning over the railing, the faint creak of a door, and a singular magnetic consciousness of being overlooked, caused him to turn slowly, but only in time to hear the rustle of a withdrawing skirt as the door was quickly closed. In an instant he felt the full force of his foolish heedlessness, but it was too late. Had the mysterious fugitive recognized him? Perhaps not, their eyes had not met, and his face had been turned away. He varied his espionage by subterfuges, which his knowledge of the old town made easy. He watched the door of the hotel, himself unseen, from the windows of a billiard saloon opposite, which he had frequented in former days. Yet he was surprised the same afternoon to see her, from his coigny of vantage, re-entering the hotel, where he was sure he had left her a few moments ago. Had she gone out by some other exit, or had she been disguised? But on entering his room that evening, he was confounded by an incident that seemed to him as convincing of her identity as it was audacious. Lying on his pillow were a few dead leaves of an odorous mountain fern, known only to the Sierras. They were tied together by a narrow blue ribbon, and had evidently been intended to attract his attention. As he took them in his hand, the distinguishing subtle aroma of the little sylvan hollow in the hills came to him like a memory and a revelation. He summoned the chambermaid. She knew nothing of them, or indeed of anyone who had entered his room. He walked cautiously into the hall. The lady's sitting room door was open, the room was empty. The occupant, said the chambermaid, had left that afternoon. He held the proof of her identity in his hand, but she herself had vanished. That she had recognized him there was now no doubt, had she divined the real object of his quest, or had she accepted it as a mere sentimental gallantry at the moment when she knew it was hopeless, and she herself was perfectly safe from pursuit? In either event he had been duped. He did not know whether to be piqued, angry or relieved of his irresolute quest. Nevertheless, he spent the rest of the twilight and the early evening in fruitlessly wandering through the one long thoroughfare of the town, until it merged into the bosky Alameda, or spacious grove, that connected it with Santa Luisa. By degrees his chagrin and disappointment were forgotten in the memories of the past, evoked by the familiar pathway. The moon was slowly riding overhead, and silvering the carriageway between the straight ebony lines of trees, while the footpaths were diapered with black and white checkers. The faint tinkling of a tramcar bell in the distance apprised him of one of the few innovations of the past. The car was approaching him, overtook him, and was passing, with its faintly illuminated windows, when, glancing carelessly up, he beheld at one of them the profile of the face which he had just thought he had lost forever. He stopped for an instant, not in indecision this time, but in a grim resolution to let no chance escape him now. The car was going slowly, it was easy to board it now, but again the tinkle of the bell indicated that it was stopping at the corner of a road beyond. He checked his pace. A lady alighted. It was she. She turned into the cross street, darkened with the shadows of some low suburban tenement houses, and he boldly followed. He was fully determined to find out her secret, and even, if necessary, to accost her for that purpose. He was perfectly aware what he was doing, and all its risks and penalties. He knew the audacity of such an introduction, but he felt in his left-hand pocket for the sprig of fern which was an excuse for it. He knew the danger of following a possible confidant of desperadoes, but he felt in his right-hand pocket for the derringer that was equal to it. They were both there, he was ready. He was nearing the convent and the oldest and most ruinous part of the town. He did not disguise from himself the gloomy significance of this. Even in the old days the crumbling adobe buildings that abutted on the old garden wall of the convent were the haunts of lawless Mexicans and vagabond peons. As the roadway began to be rough and uneven, and the gaunt outlines of the sagging roofs of tiles stood out against the sky above the lurking shadows of ruined doorways, he was prepared for the worst. As the crumbling but still massive walls of the convent garden loomed ahead, the tall, graceful, black-gowned figure he was following presently turned into the shadow of the wall itself. He quickened his pace, lest it should again escape him. Suddenly it stopped, and remained motionless. He stopped, too. At the same moment it vanished. He ran quickly forward to where it had stood, and found himself before a large iron gate, with a smaller one in the center, that had just clanged to on its rusty hinges. He rubbed his eyes. The place, the gate, the wall, were all strangely familiar. Then he stepped back into the roadway, and looked at it again. He was not mistaken. He was standing before the porter's lodge of the Convent of the Sacred Heart. Chapter 5. The day following the great stagecoach robbery found the patient proprietor of Collinson's Mill calm and untroubled in his usual seclusion. The news that had thrilled the length and breadth of Galloper's Ridge had not touched the leafy banks of the dried-up river, the hue and cry had followed the stage road, and no courier had deemed it worth his while to diverge as far as the rocky ridge which formed the only pathway to the mill. That day Collinson's solitude had been unbroken even by the haggard emigrant from the valley, with his old monotonous story of hardship and privation. The birds had flown nearer to the old mill, as if emboldened by the unwonted quiet. That morning there had been the half-human imprint of a bear's foot in the ooze beside the mill wheel, and coming home with his scant stock from the woodland pasture, he had found a golden squirrel, a beautiful, airy embodiment of the brown woods itself, calmly seated on his bar counter, with a biscuit between its baby hands. He was full of his characteristic reveries and abstractions that afternoon, falling into them even at his wood pile, leaning on his axe so still that an emerald-throated lizard, who had slid upon the log, went to sleep under the forgotten stroke. But at nightfall the wind arose at first as a distant murmur along the hillside, that died away before it reached the rocky ledge, Then it rocked the tops of the tall redwoods behind the mill, but left the mill and the dried leaves that lay in the river bed undisturbed. Then the murmur was prolonged, until it became the continuous treble of some far-off sea, and at last the wind possessed the ledge itself, driving the smoke down the stumpy chimney of the mill, rattling the sun-warped shingles on the roof, stirring the inside rafters with cool breaths, and singing over the rough projections of the outside eaves? At 9 o'clock he rolled himself up in his blankets before the fire, as was his wont, and fell asleep. It was past midnight when he was awakened by the familiar clatter of boulders down the grade, the usual simulation of a wild rush from without that encompassed the whole mill, even to that heavy impact against the door, which he had heard once before. In this he recognized merely the ordinary phenomena of his experience, and only turned over to sleep again. But this time the door rudely fell in upon him, and a figure strode over his prostrate body, with a gun leveled at his head. He sprang sideways for his own weapon, which stood by the hearth. In another second that action would have been his last, and the solitude of Seth Collinson might have remained henceforward unbroken by any mortal. But the gun of the first figure was knocked sharply upward by a second man, and the one and only shot fired that night sped harmlessly to the roof. With the report he felt his arms gripped tightly behind him, through the smoke he saw dimly that the room was filled with masked and armed men, and in another moment he was penny-wound and thrust into his empty armchair. At a signal three of the men left the room, and he could hear them exploring the other rooms and outhouses. Then the two men who had been standing beside him fell back with a certain disciplined precision, as a smooth-chinned man advanced from the open door. Going to the bar, he poured out a glass of whiskey, tossed it off deliberately, and, standing in front of Collinson, with his shoulder against the chimney and his hand resting lightly on his hip, cleared his throat. Had Collinson been an observant man, he would have noticed that the two men dropped their eyes and moved their feet with a half-impatient, perfunctory air of waiting. Had he witnessed the stage robbery, he would have recognized in the smooth-faced man the presence of the orator. But he only gazed at him with his dull, imperturbable patience. "We regret exceedingly to have to use force to a gentleman in his own house," began the orator blandly, "but we feel it our duty to prevent a repetition of the unhappy incident which occurred as we entered. We desire that you should answer a few questions, and are deeply grateful that you are still able to do so, which seemed extremely improbable a moment or two ago." He paused, coughed, and leaned back against the chimney. "How many men have you here besides yourself?"
"Nary one," said Collinson.
The interrogator glanced at the other men, who had re-entered. They nodded significantly.
"Good," he resumed. "You have told the truth, an excellent habit, and one that expedites business. Now, is there a room in this house with a door that locks?"
"Your front door doesn't."
"No."
"No cellar nor outhouse?"
"No."
"We regret that, for it will compel us, much against our wishes, to keep you bound as you are for the present. The matter is simply this: circumstances of a very pressing nature oblige us to occupy this house for a few days, possibly for an indefinite period. We respect the sacred rights of hospitality too much to turn you out of it. Indeed, nothing could be more distasteful to our feelings than to have you, in your own person, spread such a disgraceful report through the chivalrous Sierras. We must therefore keep you a close prisoner, open, however, to an offer. It is this: we propose to give you $500 for this property as it stands, provided that you leave it, and accompany a pack train which will start tomorrow morning for the lower valley as far as Thompson's Pass, binding yourself to quit the state for 3 months and keep this matter a secret. Three of these gentlemen will go with you. They will point out to you your duty, their shotguns will apprise you of any dereliction from it. What do you say?"
"Who you're talking to?" said Collinson in a dull voice.
"You remind us," said the orator suavely, "that we have not yet the pleasure of knowing."
"My name's Seth Collinson."
There was a dead silence in the room, and every eye was fixed upon the two men. The orator's smile slightly stiffened.
"Where from?" he continued blandly.
"Missouri."
"A very good place to go back to through Thompson's Pass. but you haven't answered our proposal. I reckon I don't intend to sell this house, or leave it, said Collinson simply. I trust you will not make us regret the fortunate termination of your little accident, Mr. Collinson, said the orator with a singular smile. May I ask why you object to selling out? Is it the figure? The house isn't mine, said Collinson deliberately. I built this here house for my wife what I left in Missouri. It's hers. I calculate to keep it, and live in it until she comes for it. And when I tell ye that she is dead, ye can reckon just what chance ye have of ever getting it. There was an unmistakable start of sensation in the room, followed by a silence so profound that the moaning of the wind on the mountainside was distinctly heard. A well-built man, with a mask that scarcely concealed his heavy mustachios, who had been standing with his back to the orator in half-contemptuous patience, faced around suddenly and made a step forward as if to come between the questioner and questioned. A voice from the corner ejaculated, "By G.D. Silence," said the orator sharply. Then still more harshly he turned to the others, "Pick him up, and stand him outside with a guard, and then clear out, all of you." The prisoner was lifted up and carried out, the room was instantly cleared, only the orator and the man who had stepped forward remained. Simultaneously they drew the masks from their faces, and stood looking at each other. The orator's face was smooth and corrupt, the full, sensual lips wrinkled at the corners with a sardonic humor, the man who confronted him appeared to be physically and even morally his superior, albeit gloomy and discontented in expression. He cast a rapid glance around the room, to assure himself that they were alone, and then, straightening his eyebrows as he backed against the chimney, said, "D.D. if I like this, Chivers. It's your affair, but it's mighty low-down work for a man. You might have made it easier if you hadn't knocked up Bryce's gun. That would have settled it, though no one guessed that the cur was her husband," said Chivers hotly. "If you want it settled that way, there's still time," returned the other with a slight sneer. "You've only to tell him that you're the man that ran away with his wife, and you'll have it out together, right on the ledge at 12 paces. The boys will see you through. In fact," he added, his sneer deepening, "I rather think it's what they're expecting." "Thank you, Mr. Jack Riggs," said Chivers sardonically. "I dare say it would be more convenient to some people, just before our booty is divided, if I were drilled through by a blundering shot from that hayseed, or it would seem right to your high-toned chivalry if a dead shot as I am knocked over a man who may have never fired a revolver before, but I don't exactly see it in that light, either as a man or as your equal partner. I don't think you quite understand me, my dear Jack. If you don't value the only man who is identified in all California as the leader of this gang, the man whose style and address has made it popular, yes, popular, by G.D., to every man, woman, and child who has heard of him, whose sayings and doings are quoted by the newspapers, whom people run risks to see, who has got the sympathy of the crowd, so that judges hesitate to issue warrants and constables to serve them, if you don't see the use of such a man, I do. Why, there's a column and a half in the Sacramento Union about our last job, calling me the Claude Duval of the Sierras, and speaking of my courtesy to a lady. A lady, his wife, by G.D. Our Confederate. My dear Jack, you not only don't know business values, but, P.O.N. my soul, you don't seem to understand humor. Ha, ha. For all his cynical levity, for all his affected exaggeration, there was the ring of an unmistakable and even pitiable vanity in his voice, and a self-consciousness that suffused his broad cheeks and writhed his full mouth, but seemed to deepen the frown on Riggs' face. "You know the woman hates it, and would bolt if she could even from you," said Riggs gloomily. "Think what she might do if she knew her husband were here. I tell you she holds our lives in the hollow of her hand. That's your fault, Mr. Jack Riggs, you would bring your sister with her infernal convent innocence and simplicity into our hut in the hollow. She was meek enough before that. But this is sheer nonsense. I have no fear of her. The woman don't live who would go back on Godfrey Chivers for a husband. Besides, She went off to see your sister at the convent at Santa Clara as soon as she passed those bonds off on Charlie to get rid of. Think of her traveling with that DD fool lawyer all the way to Stockton, and his bonds, which we had put back in her bag, alongside of them all the time, and he telling her he was going to stop their payment, and giving her the letter to mail for him, eh? Well, we'll have time to get rid of her husband before she gets back. If he don't go easy, well. None of that, Chivers, you understand, once for all, interrupted Riggs peremptorily. If you cannot see that you're making away with that woman's husband would damn that boasted reputation you make so much of and set every man's hand against us, I do, and I won't permit it. It's a rotten business enough our coming on him as we have, and if this wasn't the only godforsaken place where we could divide our stuff without danger and get it away off the high roads, I'd pull up stakes at once. Let her stay at the convent, then, and be DD to her, said Chivers roughly. She'll be glad enough to be with your sister again, and there's no fear of her being touched there. But I want to put an end to that, too, returned Riggs sharply. I do not choose to have my sister any longer implicated with our confederate or your mistress. No more of that, you understand me. The two men had been standing side by side, leaning against the chimney. Chivers now faced his companion, his full lips wreathed into an evil smile. I think I understand you, Mr. Jack Riggs, or I beg your pardon Rivers, or whatever your real name may be, he began slowly. Sadie Collinson, the mistress of Judge Godfrey Chivers, formerly of Kentucky, was good enough company for you the day you dropped down upon us in our little house in the hollow of Galloper's Ridge. We were living quite an idyllic, pastoral life there, weren't we, she and me, hidden from the censorious eye of society and Collinson, obeying only the voice of nature and the little birds. It was a happy time, he went on with a grimly affected sigh, disregarding his companion's impatient gesture. You were young then, waging your fight against society, and fresh, uncommonly fresh, I may say from your first exploit. And a very stupid, clumsy, awkward exploit, too, Mr. Riggs, if you will pardon my freedom. You wanted money, and you had an ugly temper, and you had lost both to a gambler, so you stopped the coach to rob him, and had to kill two men to get back your paltry $1,000, after frightening a whole coach load of passengers, and letting Wells, Fargo, and Company's treasure box with $50,000 in it slide. It was a stupid, a blundering, a cruel act, Mr. Riggs, and I think I told you so at the time. It was a waste of energy and material, and made you, not a hero, but a stupid outcast. I think I proved this to you, and showed you how it might have been done. Dry up on that, interrupted Riggs impatiently. You offered to become my partner, and you did. Pardon me. Observe, my impetuous friend, that my contention is that you poisoned our blameless Eden in the hollow, that you were our serpent, and that this Sadie Collinson, over whom you have become so fastidious, whom you knew as my mistress, was obliged to become our confederate. You did not object to her when we formed our gang, and her house became our hiding place and refuge. You took advantage of her woman's wit and fine address in disposing of our booty, you availed yourself, with the rest, of the secrets she gathered as my mistress, just as you were willing to profit by the superior address of her paramour, your humble servant, when your own face was known to the sheriff, and your old methods pronounced brutal and vulgar. Excuse me, but I must insist upon this, and that you dropped down upon me and Sadie Collinson exactly as you have dropped down here upon her husband. Enough of this, said Riggs angrily. I admit the woman is part and parcel of the gang, and gets her share or you get it for her, he added sneeringly, but that doesn't permit her to mix herself with my family affairs. Pardon me again, interrupted Chivers softly. Your memory, my dear Riggs, is absurdly defective. We knew that you had a young sister in the mountains, from whom you discreetly wished to conceal your real position. We respected, and I trust shall always respect, your noble reticence. but do you remember the night you were taking her to school at Santa Clara two nights before the fire when you were recognized on the road near Skinner's, and had to fly with her for your life, and brought her to us your two dear old friends, M.R. and Mrs. Barker of Chicago, who had a pastoral home in the forest? You remember how we took her in, yes, doubly took her in and kept your secret from her? And do you remember how this woman, this mistress of mine and our confederate, while we were away, saved her from the fire on our only horse, caught the stagecoach, and brought her to the convent? Riggs walked towards the window, turned, and coming back, held out his hand. Yes, she did it, and I thanked her, as I thank you. He stopped and hesitated, as the other took his hand. But, blank it all, Chivers, don't you see that Alice is a young girl, and this woman is, you know what I mean? Somebody might recognize her, and that would be worse for Alice than even if it were known what Alice's brother was. G.D. If these two things were put together, the girl would be ruined forever. Jack, said Chivers suddenly, you want this woman out of the way. Well, dash it all, she nearly separated us, and I'll be frank with you as between man and man. I'll give her up. There are women enough in the world, and hang it, we're partners, after all. Then you abandon her, said Riggs slowly, his eyes fixed on his companion. Yes. She's getting a little too maundering lately. It will be a ticklish job to manage, for she knows too much, but it will be done. There's my hand on it. Riggs not only took no notice of the proffered hand, but his former look of discontent came back with an ill-concealed addition of loathing and contempt. We'll drop that now, he said shortly, we've talked here alone long enough already. The men are waiting for us. He turned on his heel into the inner room. Chivers remained standing by the chimney until his stiffened smile gave way under the working of his writhing lips, then he turned to the bar, poured out and swallowed another glass of whiskey at a single gulp, and followed his partner with half-closed lids that scarcely veiled his ominous eyes. The men, with the exception of the sentinel stationed on the rocky ledge and the one who was guarding the unfortunate Collinson, were drinking and gambling away their prospective gains around a small pile of portmanteaus and saddlebags, heaped in the center of the room. They contained the results of their last successes, but one pair of saddlebags bore the mildewed appearance of having been cached, or buried, some time before. Most of their treasure was in packages of gold dust, and from the conversation that ensued, it appeared that, owing to the difficulties of disposing of it in the mountain towns, the plan was to convey it by ordinary pack mule to the unfrequented valley, and thence by an emigrant wagon, on the old emigrant trail, to the southern counties, where it could be no longer traced. Since the recent robberies, the local express companies and bankers had refused to receive it, except the owners were known and identified. There had been but one box of coin, which had already been speedily divided up among the band. Drafts, bills, bonds, and valuable papers had been usually introduced to one Charlie, who acted as a flying messenger to a corrupt broker in Sacramento, who played the role of the band's fence. It had been the duty of Chivers to control this delicate business, even as it had been his peculiar function to open all the letters and documents. This he had always lightened by characteristic levity and sarcastic comments on the private revelations of the contents. The rough, ill-spelled letter of the miner to his wife, enclosing a draft, or the more sentimental effusion of an emigrant swain to his sweetheart, with the gift of a specimen, had always received due attention at the hands of this elegant humorist. But the operation was conducted tonight with business severity and silence. The two leaders sat opposite to each other, in what might have appeared to the rest of the band a scarcely veiled surveillance of each other's actions. When the examination was concluded, and the more valuable enclosures put aside, the despoiled letters were carried to the fire and heaped upon the coals. Presently the chimney added its roar to the moaning of the distant hillside, a few sparks leaped up and died out in the midnight air, as if the pathos and sentiment of the unconscious correspondents had exhaled with them. That's a DD foolish thing to do, growled French Pete over his cards. Why? Demanded Chivers sharply. Why, it makes a flare in the sky that any scout can see, and a scent for him to follow. We're 4 miles from any traveled road, returned Chivers contemptuously, and the man who could see that glare and smell that smoke would be on his way here already. That reminds me that that chap you've tied up that Collinson allows he wants to see you, continued French Pete.
To see me, repeated Chivers.
You mean the captain?
I reckon he means you, returned French Pete, he said the man who talks so putty.
The men looked at each other with a smile of anticipation, and put down their cards. Chivers walked towards the door, one or two rose to their feet as if to follow, but Riggs stopped them peremptorily.
Sit down, he said roughly, then, as Chivers passed him, he added to him in a lower tone, remember.
Slightly squaring his shoulders and opening his coat, to permit a rhetorical freedom, which did not, however, prevent him from keeping touch with the butt of his revolver, Chivers stepped into the open air. Collinson had been moved to the shelter of an overhang of the roof, probably more for the comfort of the guard, who sat cross-legged on the ground near him, than for his own. Dismissing the man with a gesture, Chivers straightened himself before his captive.
We deeply regret that your unfortunate determination, my dear sir, has been the means of depriving us of the pleasure of your company, and you of your absolute freedom, but may we cherish the hope that your desire to see me may indicate some change in your opinion.
By the light of the sentry's lantern left upon the ground, Chivers could see that Collinson's face wore a slightly troubled and even apologetic expression.
I've been thinking, said Collinson, raising his eyes to his captor with a singularly new and shy admiration in them,
maybe not so much of what you said, easy how you said it, and it's kinder bothered me, sit in here, that I ain't been acting to you boys quite on the square.
I've said to myself, Collinson, thar ain't another house betwixt Bald Top and Skinner's war them fellows can get a bite or a drink to help themselves, and you ain't offered em neither.
It ain't no matter who they are or how they came, whether they came crawling along the road from the valley, or dropped down upon you like them rocks from the grade, yure they are, and it's your duty, easy long easy you keep this your house for your wife in trust, so to speak, for wanderers. And I ain't forgetting your general soft style and easy gait with me when you come here.
It ain't every man as could walk into another man's house arter the owner of it had grabbed a gun,
easy soft speaking, easy overlooking, and easy perlite easy you.
I've acted mighty rough and low down, and I know it.
And I sent for you to say that you and your folks can use this house and all that's in it easy long easy you're in trouble.
I've told you why I couldn't sell the house to ye, and why I couldn't leave it.
But ye can use it, and while you're here, and when you go, Collinson don't tell nobody.
I don't know what ye mean by binding myself to keep your secret. When Collinson says a thing he sticks to it, and when he passes his word with a man, or a man passes his word with him, it don't need no bit of paper.
There was no doubt of its truth.
In the grave, upraised eyes of his prisoner, Chivers saw the certainty that he could trust him, even far more than he could trust anyone within the house he had just quitted.
But this very certainty, for all its assurance of safety to himself, filled him, not with remorse, which might have been an evanescent emotion, but with a sudden alarming and terrible consciousness of being in the presence of a hitherto unknown and immeasurable power. He had no pity for man who trusted him, he had no sense of shame in taking advantage of it, he even felt an intellectual superiority in this want of sagacity in his dupe, but he still felt in some way defeated, insulted, shocked, and frightened. At first, like all scoundrels, he had measured the man by himself, was suspicious and prepared for rivalry, but the grave truthfulness of Collinson's eyes left him helpless. He was terrified by this unknown factor. The right that contends and fights often stimulates its adversary, the right that yields leaves the victor vanquished. Chivers could even have killed Collinson in his vague discomfiture, but he had a terrible consciousness that there was something behind him that he could not make way with. That was why this accomplished rascal felt his flaccid cheeks grow purple and his glib tongue trip before his captive. But Collinson, more occupied with his own shortcomings, took no note of this,
and Chivers quickly recovered his wits, if not his former artificiality. "All right," he said quickly, with a hurried glance at the door behind him. "Now that you think better of it, I'll be frank with you, and tell you I'm your friend. You understand, your friend. Don't talk much to those men, don't give yourself away to them," he laughed this time in absolute natural embarrassment. "Don't talk about your wife, and this house, but just say you've made the thing up with me, you know, and I'll see you through." An idea, as yet vague, that he could turn Collinson's unexpected docility to his own purposes, possessed him even in his embarrassment, and he was still more strangely conscious of his inordinate vanity gathering a fearful joy from Collinson's evident admiration. It was heightened by his captive's next words. "If I wasn't tied, I'd shake hands with ye on that. You're the kind o' man, Mr. Chivers, that I caught o' need to from the first. If this house wasn't hers, I'd a been tempted to cotton to your offer, too, and mebbe made your one myself, for it seems to me your style and mine would sorter jibe together. But I see you sabe what's in my mind, and make allowance. We don't want no bit o' paper to shake hands on that. Your secret and your folks' secret is mine, and I don't blab that any more than I'd blab to them what you've just told me." Under a sudden impulse, Chivers leaned forward, and, albeit with somewhat unsteady hands and an embarrassed will, untied the cords that held Collinson in his chair. As the freedman stretched himself to his full height, he looked gravely down into the bleared eyes of his captor, and held out his strong right hand. Chivers took it. Whether there was some occult power in Collinson's honest grasp, I know not, but there sprang up in Chivers' agile mind the idea that a good way to get rid of Mrs. Collinson was to put her in the way of her husband's finding her, and for an instant, in the contemplation of that idea, this supreme rascal absolutely felt an embarrassing glow of virtue,